大家好，我是殷一平。很抱歉，我今天只能用中文给大家来讲解这个中国陶瓷的这一部分，然后佩林来帮我翻译。
So Yiping will be, of course, speaking in Chinese. I will be doing translations for her.
今天我们带来的这个无感艺术呢，是从这个陶瓷还有古琴。还有闻香，还有品茶，来感受我们中国的艺术文化。
So today, we are here to, I want to make this really just a collaborative effort. So if you guys have any questions, comments, feel free to stop us. But of course, here we're going to sort of go through and talk about some of these Chinese traditional arts, just for the sake of time. This would be, of course, the Guqin. It's a seven-stringed zither. And, of course, certain things like tea making, tea brewing, and, of course, incense would be some of the lecture topics today.
我们看到的现在的中国陶瓷呢，其实它属于工艺美术这个范畴内的。
In terms of porcelain making, we're going to specifically talk about the process in the artistry of Chinese porcelain, more specifically the production process and glazing, and also, of course, I have a background in Chinese, what they call gongbi, so court style painting. So it's a lot of outlining, right? And then putting in, it's Chinese watercolor, right? But the slow type, you know, in Chinese painting, there's court painting and scholarly painting. Scholarly painting is more xieyi. Xieyi would be, you know, the fast brush strokes. That would be the scholarly type. But here, specifically, if you can even look at this piece, it's a very labor-intensive process that we'll talk about more later.
我们制作出来都需要72道工艺才能制作完成。
To complete even just, upon just a simple inspection, this cup, it actually requires 72 separate steps.To complete such a thing.
然后大家可以看到呢，第一个呢就是炼泥，就是现在看到的这个呢，就是景德镇的这个磁石。然后从磁石呢，我们把它打成瓷泥，这个呢是第一步。
The raw materials for the clay. So one of the reasons why porcelain is so specific, of course.Is because the material is actually very special. It's only native to where you can find the material, right? So this is, for instance, a very big component of this clay is kaolinite. So kaolinite is actually a very slow capacity clay. So for people that are into maybe geology or soil science, you might know a little bit about this. But it has to be that specific type of clay. For the production of porcelain. So as you can imagine, lots of these clays have been mined for actually thousands of years. And to this day, of course, the material for the production of fine porcelain is actually, it's a finite resource.
炼完瓷泥之后，我们第二步呢就是拉胚，就是等于是我们要制作这个杯子的形制嘛。然后这一步就叫拉胚，就现在我们图上的这个所制。因为在于中国古代呢，它所有的这些机器转盘呢，都是用脚用人工来旋转，然后来拉成这个圆的形。
So the pieces of course, the large sort of rock-like materials are first grounded up, right? So after it's grounded up, then you have to form them into usable sort of pieces, right? Slabs, and then the slabs are actually cut into brick, sort of pieces of brick, right? Brick-sized pieces. And then the potter goes ahead and, of course, he's on the potter wheel. Traditionally, of course, these are all hand-cranked, foot-cranked potter's wheel. But now, of course, things are electric.
下面呢就是我们拉完坯之后就要修坯嘛，要把它修得比较规整。然后我们其实每一个这个出品的最高的一个标准呢，就是它必须是一个正圆形的。如果比如说有其他的椭圆形的，它就是有瑕疵的。
So as you can see here, these are these cups are quite uniform, and so in the production of these things, you can see that that's actually a mold, right?
So none of this is really freehand. It has to meet very specific specifications for size, dimension, curvature. Because you know, when you have a set like that, one that doesn't match all the other ones, you know, that's a very big issue.
我们这样地坯完修坯完了之后呢，我们就要修坯，就把这个很厚的这个胚胎呢，把它修得很薄，然后这样摸上去呢，就像纸一样的薄。
So in this process here, this is the thinning process. So after it has the general shape, this is the process where the material is thinned out. And so you can see here in these cups, these are actually very thin. So both sides are gradually thinned out. I'm not sure about, of course, these are sort of bowl size, but.
然后我们下面呢就是说它拉完胚之后呢，我们就要晾胚。这个晾胚呢，就是在景德镇这个地区呢，它还是在选择自然晾胚的这个为最佳的一个好的一个支持的一个标准吧。
The region that we're actually talking about is Jingdezhen. And Jingdezhen is one of the centers for porcelain production for many hundreds of years. And the process that they go through, I think you can imagine that local potters may choose to artificially dry you know, their product. But in Jingdezhen, the traditional process actually follows the climate and the local weather. As you can imagine, if all of these dry too quickly, they'll start to crack. So it's up to really the production manager, the artist, to really time it very well. So if during, for instance, the summer months and the winter months in China, the production of porcelainware stops because during the summertime, it's way too humid, right? It rains, it's monsoonal in China, right? So it's going to be way too wet for the drying process. During the winter, of course, it's too cold and too dry.
然后我们就是在晾完坯完成之后呢，这个坯胎就可以用了，然后我们在上面就可以画花啊、刻花啊什么的，就可以在胚胎上进行了。就是其实陶瓷它主要分为呢有两种，一种呢就是一次性烧成的。
After the drying process, sometimes of course glazes are applied, right? And then you can paint on top of the glaze. So that would be an over glaze. Some instances, it's actually painted right on top of the clay. And that would be an under glaze. So there are basically two types. One type is you just fire it once, right? So you can see these persimmons here. These were fired once. But for some certain more complicated pieces, those require multiple firings because every color requires a different layer. And so that's why for the production of something like this, anytime you see anything similar to that, it actually goes through multiple firings.
这个呢，就是我们刚才说的，就是在画完花之后呢，我们要吃一个釉子，就是现在大家看呢，很光亮、质感很强的这个，不是釉料出现的颜光亮，是它的釉子出来的颜色。
So of course, this shine, this sheen that you see, this is from the glazing process, and this is not because of the material. This is of course the glaze that you see. So in antique porcelain, sometimes looking at the glaze is very indicative for ascertaining the age of the piece, right? Depending on where the piece is, this might also dull at a different pace, right? So sometimes we see pieces that have come out of China for a few hundred years or something, they might age a little differently than a piece that is left in China. So that's one thing. Has to keep in mind.
对这个柚子的出现呢，就是我们说的是这个陶瓷嘛。其实陶和瓷是两种，然后呢，陶呢它具备有极强的吸水性，然后由于瓷器的这个出现嘛，也就是柚子的出现，所以呢，就是我们看到所有瓷。 瓷器的面上，就这种光亮的这个东西才是怎么用的。
So for the clay, of course, the Chinese term for 陶瓷, 陶 is actually the clay itself, and then 瓷 is actually the clays.
好，现在我们看到的这个呢，就是柴窑，就是过去古代呢，烧制皇家瓷器的时候呢，都是通过这个柴窑来进行烧制的。
So this kiln is actually one of the kilns that have been used for many centuries. It's the most traditional type of kiln that you see in China. Many of these are still in use. As you can see, this is the glaze that they use is actually a very natural glaze, traditionally used in.Even for imperial works.
Okay, 刚才我们说的这个制瓷器在工具里面，然后在这个烧柴窑之前，纸其实完成了二十多步，在这个窑的烧烤过程中要完成五十多步。
In the firing process, so we talked about 70 steps of for the completion of the final product, right? But actually, the firing process is.About 50 of those steps is completed in the kiln. So we think that, oh, everything's before the firing, then the firing is all done. But no, it's actually 50 steps are actually completed within the firing process in the kiln.
就是我们现在在市面上看到的，就是当代的陶瓷很少是通过这个柴窑在烧制，因为它的成本非常高。
The traditional firing process, as you can see, is very expensive. So because we're using traditional, you know, wood fuel. These are not electric gas or anything. Gas kilns, none of that. So as you can imagine, this is, of course, very expensive. We also have to control the temperature, right? And so this firing process, this traditional way of firing is actually quite rare in China because this can only be reserved for very high value.
现在景德镇呢，就是有一个完全复原的这个柴窑，只有一个。
As an example, in the area of production of 景德镇, which is of course very famous for the porcelain ware, there's only one kiln in operation.
然后柴窑烧出来的和比如说漆窑啊或电窑烧出来的瓷器的最主要的区别就是它的花色。
In terms of using a gas or electric kiln.The major difference from the traditional is that in the traditional way of making, the colors are actually very vibrant.
好，我们就是在烧窑的这个过程中呢，就是它有瓷器分的两种的。第一种呢，就是釉下彩呢，它是一次性烧成的。然后釉上彩呢，就是在出窑以后呢，我们需要再画花，然后呢再进行烧制。
So we were talking about the overglaze and underglaze aspects of porcelain ware. For an underglaze, you know, the image is painted on and then the glaze is put on. That's a one-time process. But for the overglaze, where there's a glaze and then, of course, all the images, as in that one, that actually takes multiple firings.
对，现在我们看到的这个盖碗呢，就是这个黑地儿摆花的这个，大家可以到时候就是近距离看一下。然后呢，它的这个发色还有这个黑的颜色。
So in this example here, you know, the black overlaid with all of the colorful images of the flowers and, you know, the lotus and whatnot, that actually takes about 10 firings to complete.
好，那我们现在呢，就是说我们现在看到的，现在我们在推广的这个当代陶瓷的这一块呢，现在在制作在中国呢，分为五大艺术产区，就是我们当代的这个陶瓷呢。
In the production of, talking about the major production centers in China, namely there is, of course, we're talking about 景德镇, which is, that's a major production center. In Fujian province, there is Dehua, and you might recognize the Guanyin image over there. That's actually a lot of bone china comes from that area, and of course that's been popular for...quite a number of centuries, and then Longquan, and also these terracotta figurines, sort of. That's the shooting part. And then the and also Liming, which is in Hunan province.
对，然后我们为什么会把这个五大产区呢挑出来给大家介绍一下呢？就是因为它从古代有一个延续，然后并且有一个创新的东西。
So these five centers, of course, historically, they've been major production centers, but now actually the government is sponsoring and supporting a lot of these artisans within those regions to keep production because they have distinctly different traditions.
他们下面呢就是景德镇呢，大家可能都比较熟悉，就是一说景德镇，可能都觉得中国的陶瓷都是从景德镇而来的。
So when we're talking about Chinese porcelain, many people might actually just think of the production region of 景德镇, and this blue and white porcelain that you see, antiques or even the newer stuff, you know, that is all from 景德镇, this blue and white porcelain.
景德镇其实最主要的特点呢，它就是能很好的把官窑的这个制品呢，然后从古代完全复原到跟过去一样，然后是一个复制这个工艺的等级。
One thing very, of course, remarkable about the area of 景德镇 is that there are many artisans, right? And the artisans are actually able to emulate the imperial style. The execution of the pieces are actually, one might say, lots of imitation antiques come out of 景德镇. But on that vein, of course, you can see here in this slide, there are really contemporary pieces too that are quite remarkable and are quite noted. Lots of famous sort of modern artists of the tradition come out of that area.
那我后面看到的这些呢，比如像文化的这个白瓷的瓷塑，然后它就不是景德镇这个产区的，它就是德化这个产区的，它的这个瓷土啊都是不一样的。所以就是这个，在中国几大产区呢，它制瓷的不同的这个有不同特点。
The other area of production is 德化 and 德化 of course is in 福建 province. And this is actually quite common. You know, the goddess of mercy, Bodhisattva, and it's a very white bone china.
对，现在给大家普及一下，就是现在德化呢是被誉为世界陶瓷。
Actually, the center of bone china production, or even representative of Chinese porcelain, may not even be 景德镇. It's actually 德化. Because when you think of bone china, this is what comes to mind for many Chinese people. This very nice white type of porcelain, pure white.
后面呢，我们看到就是这些龙泉窑呢，它主要就是以这个黑胎青瓷、青釉。
The area of Longquan in Zhejiang province, you can see their special type of porcelain ware is this light blue glaze.
湖南宜宾釉下彩五彩这块呢，就是我们要特别知道呢，就是它是世界陶瓷烧制的最高温度，就是我们之前所烧的这个景德镇的这个彩瓷呢，它是釉上彩，但是宜宾的五彩呢，它是釉下彩，它是。一次性烧成的，必须要达到这个1380度的高温才会出现，我们看到更好看的颜色。
So in talking about the firing process, from Hunan province, this waning ware, this is the highest temperature that is reached by any sort of porcelain making process. This has to reach a temperature of 1300 Celsius, and so that owes to actually the very bright colors that you see in this type of porcelain.So 1300 degrees before we, and this is actually completed all in one go, not multiple firing. So this is it is the most complicated production method because it requires a high level of skill. Imagine doing that all in one go, right? And then putting it in the kiln and having that as the final product. That's actually pretty amazing.
下面呢，这个呢是广东佛山的这个陶塑。它其实就比较接近于这个雕塑这个品质的，因为它是陶泥做的。
So these figurines are sort of, I like to think of them as, so I'm, of course I'm Cantonese, but this is from Canton province, from the area of Foshan, right? Some people might know Foshan because it's sort of the southern Kung Fu center, right? From Foshan, right? And these are sort of these terracotta type figurines that are made that Foshan is very famous for.
所以就是我们希望呢给大家介绍的这个景致不同的这个形式吧，也就是它不一定就是来自于景镇。
And that's why we want to sort of focus on sort of the breadth of what Chinese porcelain is, because most people when we talk about porcelain, they think about, oh, it has to be Jingzhen, which is not really the case. There's a lot of different centers of porcelain making within China.
我们现在看到的这个小海螺，大家猜的什么材质制作的？
So if you guys look at this slide, you can probably guess what material this is. This is of course it doesn't come from nature, but the shell is what they call imitation, sort of lifelike porcelain.
我们呢，就是陶瓷的这个最高级别的，就是这个仿真瓷。
The pinnacle of the art, art form in porcelainware is actually this imitation of sort of natural objects. In the next slides, we'll see not, well, this is of course a shell, right? But in the next slides, we'll see more of this.
对，就像是我们还有一些这种仿制这种小的瓷的饰子，然后其实呢，它呢是一个茶叶罐。So
this is of course a porcelain piece, right? I guess also I'm a botanist, so this is not good enough for me. but this is actually a tea canister, so this is actually. Not from the dollar store.
我们现在看到的这些呢，都是属于仿真瓷这个类型的。就是说呢，我们是陶瓷呢，模绘画加起来会把这个东西仿得栩栩如生嘛，来代表它陶瓷的一个最高工艺的一个水平的一个展现。
So these artisans, you know, in sort of pursuit of sort of pushing the art form, they've managed to. Imitate certain things, like you can see citrus fruits, right? There's that bowl. I think there's also like a water chestnut in there, and other things. I remember there was this one time where actually these imitation pieces are getting more and more common in China, where if you guys go to some of these tea brewing places, they might have a piece that is a very small piece, like a peanut or something, right? And then, so don't go trying to make sure that it's a real peanut, you know, it's a fake peanut, not a real one, you don't want to bite into it, right? So I was almost tempted to bite into one of these. And that's why, because these actually look quite real, you know, when well done, well executed.
形制的，然后包括是不同工艺的这些陶瓷。
This piece that you see here, this Daoguang piece, Qing Dynasty piece, this is an example of something that is really fine because, of course, the red, this is a coral red piece, and all the red, of course, has been applied on top, and then the negative image, the white, is actually the porcelain that you see.
这件呢，也是我们。
This is a canister, a lid jar, I guess. And this is a Ming Dynasty piece. Actually, we were just paying a visit to Christie's, and of course, these examples you can see quite a few of. And something to note is notice the glaze on top. It's not very shiny, right? So this is the Ming Dynasty, so at least like 500-600 years have passed, right? So that's one of the things that, but of course you have to be careful too, because in China nowadays I believe that they are pretty good at sort of emulating the dullness of some of these pieces too, so
这个新的瓷器和新的这个茶席呢，就是把之前古代的皇家用瓷的这些制式还有纹饰呢，把它集合并且重新设计了以后。
So some of the work that, of course, Ms. Yiping does is she wants really to sort of foster a great, not only a greater understanding, but of course a greater love for these Chinese traditional porcelain pieces. But these days, of course, there's a lot of collectors out there that focus heavily on antiques, of course. But there's a whole other area that sometimes people miss here in the States is that there are these really high quality modern pieces. And these modern pieces, as you can imagine, lots of these imperial pieces may be quite big. The reason why we have some of these smaller things is one that it serves a utilitarian use, right? So she's using that, that guy one, that knitted cup to brew tea, you'll see later. And this is really to sort of, these things have you can use these things, right? So that's why it has to apply to our everyday lives to make it relevant. If it's something big and something that you could, you know, that it's put in your living room or something, that might not be as intimate as something that you use every day. For example, for tea brewing, for drinking, or anything like that.
像我们这次带来的这个茶席嘛，是我觉得选用了一个就是比较符合我手的大小，然后是按照完全柴窑烧制复古的这种方式呢，按照官窑制式来烧制成的这个品质。
So the piece that she has in front of her, actually she selected for the dimensions, because for the brewing of tea, of course, and it would have to fit in the palm of her hand, or reasonably sized, right? So it's not too big for her hand. And also it's traditionally done, traditionally fired in accordance with these imperial pieces.
我希望呢，就是说有更多的人能了解到这些精美的陶瓷，而不是只是在博物馆里面看的。
Yeah, and talking about the relevance of these pieces, you know, these pieces have an actual use, and so we might, you know, visit a museum and see these things behind glass, right? But we have to remember that these things had a use and, in the imperial family. High strata of Chinese society, of course, these pieces were traded, but yeah, these pieces had a use, and so that's why to put relevance to today, we can actually use these pieces.
对，所以就是说，我们这次呢，就是说是通过这种茶席来进行跟大家一个分享嘛，然后呢，希望就是通过茶的这个品茶这个分享，然后大家重视这个安全和品质。
Talking about the use of these pieces, that's why she chose a Chinese tea ceremony, so that we can sort of share using the use of these pieces and a very utilitarian thing.
现在我们可以选四杯吧，就叫四位感兴趣的可以找钱，然后给大家进行尝。
So if there's four people that want to come up. Actually, we can grab maybe four chairs, and then we can you can enjoy tea with us. While I'll be playing some music. But one of the things that the ancient people do is the appreciation of incense, right? And in this example here, in this slide, this is actually agar wood. Agar wood in Japan, of course, is of course very very popular as well. It's one of these. Pretty rare woods, tropical woods, resinous woods, right? And of course, if you've gone over to Chinatown, sometimes you see, they haven't been as common these days, I think, but these sandalwood fans, right? Really strong scent for maybe a few months or something, and then it loses its scent, right? So of course, sandalwood, aloes wood, agar wood, sometimes they call it agar wood. These are all very sort of expensive materials to make incense out of. Here, so this is just the two. Go ahead and these are stick incense, right? So because I'm sure we're not allowed to burn anything in here, right? there's probably a smoke detector in here. But go ahead and actually sniff it closely, and then you'll smell some of the sandalwood, the scent of the sandalwood. I'll just go ahead and pass this around. Incense in China had quite a few uses, right? So one is sometimes they're extruded and made into sort of these spiral type things, right? In temples, for religious use, right? In terms of the religious use, it was actually to keep time, right? So for instance, like the stick incense that's being passed around, that's about 45 minutes or so. That's how long that stick incense lasts in terms of the burn time. But for some of these cones, these spiral cones, as you can imagine, could be a day or even like 2 days or something, right? And then these cones that you sometimes see, these are a Japanese invention, actually. But of course, the Chinese have taken those on as well. And lots of incense productions, not only in China, but also in Japan. So some of these cones with a hole in the middle, you might find. Certain incense might have fillers, depending on the grade of incense. So that's something to be careful about too, because it's something that we're burning, combusting. So as you can imagine, some of these materials are expensive. So sometimes a lot of fillers and very little scent. Incense burners, of course, sensors, and if you can see the that sort of like a mythical creature. But these things are a lot of fun because even during the ancient times, you would see that these, of course, in the mouth and the eyes, sometimes there might be a hole. So it's really fun to have the smoke go out. I have a crane at home, for instance. It's a lot of fun. Of course, she's already brewing some tea, so I'm going to touch upon tea. Tea, of course, is a very big area we can spend days and days talking about tea. But and if you have any questions, go ahead and stop me. I can answer them for you. Of course, Camellia sinensis is the variety that Chinese tea comes from. Not only variety sinensis, but there's also Assamica. So Assam teas are also a very common variety grown within China. And of course, two of those varieties give us all of the teas that are produced in China. It's really the terroir aspect that, and the, of course, production, right? Sometimes fermentation, the firing of the tea leaves that give us all the different types of tea, right? And the very green, very white tea, very least tampered with, I guess. Because, lots of white tea is just basically air dried, right? And it's basically green. So very little oxidation. So you get the very natural taste and aroma of the tea. And of course, this is the tea plant. And I believe this is the large leaf one, which is the Assamica, variety Assamica. But basically, the leaf size, of course, that's the main difference. In A, you can see this whole tree, it's quite tall. Of course, for the purposes of production, these bushes have to be hedged, of course, right? So a tea plantation, everything has to be sort of level and easy to pick. And then if you look at actually that middle image, that apple-like looking structure, that's the fruit of the tea plant. Cross-section of the fruit, as you can see, there's the seeds in there, right? The seeds are housed within the fruit. And then G is the female structure, right? Before it's pollinated, before the fruit actually enlarges. That's G. So I think this is not jasmine. This is a white tea, an aged they call it peony white. I don't know if it's aged, it's a fresh, so it's a very white tea actually, but I think it's slightly aged. If I get, this is actually a wild, sort of a wild tea. It comes from a wild bush tea, so this is not from a farm. I mean, these things are managed, of course. When you go to China, they talk about, this comes from a wild bush. It's like, oh, these bushes are, of course, managed, right? So, but of course, the size of the tree sometimes in these wild trees is that they have to climb really high, right? So sometimes that's why monkeys are actually trained to pick these leaves. So they call that monkey picked, right? Which is, of course, I think very expensive nowadays in China. But a very green tea all the way to the right, which is puer, right? Puer is not just a black tea, but it's also fermented, right? So puer is the type of tea that you might come across at even like dim sum restaurants, right? So puer tea is a very black tea. It cuts through the grease of dim sum, right? So that's why the candies love it, right? So, and that's, of course, a fermented black tea. All the stuff in the middle that you see is, of course, in blue. That light blue is oolong, and then so forth. There's also red tea.
Thank you.
was spring feelings or spring thoughts. Kunsi, that actually is a Ming Dynasty piece. It was published in 1549. So that piece, of course, that actually only survives within that one handbook. So possibly, of course, very likely so, that this piece is older than 1549. So has anyone listened to Qin music at all, by any chance? Raise your hand if you have. I see one, two, oh, three. Very nice. Of course, the Qin we can talk about for days and days, but if you can believe it, Qin players actually, I don't know if any of you know about the Guqin tradition, but it matches the rise and fall of the Chinese scholarly class. Right? So during the late Qing dynasty, that was when many of the scholars, you know, it was a dying class of people. So in its heyday, about 10 scholars, you would expect that at least 7 or 8 of them would know how to play the Guqin. And so sometimes we talk about the four arts of a scholar, right? Which is Qin, Qi, Shu, Hua. Qin would be the Qin itself. So of course, music, a well-learned scholar would be expected to know these four arts. Right? Qi is the Chinese game of Go. Right? Shu is literature. Hua is painting, so calligraphy and painting and so forth. So of course, it's a very Confucian thing as well. But the Guqin has been very highly revered all throughout China's history. One, it's a very quiet instrument, right? So I'm sure you guys might have come across. Yeah, it's very sort of sweet sounding, right? It's not very bright, so that's why I would owe that to its sort of meditative qualities, right? One of my teachers, he gave me the analogy of why did the scholars pick the Qin? One, it's very quiet, right? So it requires a very sort of just an intimate group of friends, right? For a gathering, then you would play the Qin to share music, right? So the environment has to be very quiet, and you have to remember, these are very, actually, modern strings, so these are already relatively loud. So on silk strings, they would be a lot more soft. You hear a lot more, perhaps, rich overtones, plus the texture of the strings, too. As I do the stopped notes and the slides, you would hear the texture of the silk strings as well. Of course, in the modern day, there are some purists out there that talk about the Guqin and how it should only have or be strung with silk. I don't know if any of you know, but the Qin on top, that was actually auctioned, I would say 4 or 5 years ago in China. That belonged to Emperor Song Huizong, so it's 900 years old. It was a favorite instrument by Emperor Tianlong, Qing Dynasty Emperor. That was auctioned at about, I believe, $22 million. Yeah, record prices. It was, at that time, even more than any Stradivarius violin. I think a few months after that, a very well-preserved, unaltered Stradivarius was auctioned a couple million more than the Guqin. So some of these instruments are the most expensive in the world, right? Of course, this is, I believe, an exception because, you know, of the high-profile case, you know, favored, so, you know, very famous Song Dynasty Emperor, and then Emperor Tianlong loving that instrument so much that he had a special lacquer box made for the instrument to house it. I have a question in mind.
So, does it have the original silk strings in it, or it has been replaced?
Original, as in, they might be 100 years old. You know, these things are, of course, organic, so they do disintegrate, but I think they might, I don't know how old the strings are, but I believe that they did have sort of a party right before, you know, right before the auctioning of this instrument where an older player was playing on it. I remember seeing a very short video somewhere online of you have to remember, this instrument is very well preserved, so it was not played very much at all, because the lacquer actually has been unaltered. It's never been relacquered, is my understanding. So what you see is the original lacquer, and that's not typical. For a chin that's been played throughout the centuries, you would have to, even my new instruments, you know, you would have to relacquer maybe every 5-6 years or something if there's a tiny crack, especially along the where the string path is, right? Those are areas where your fingers will always come across. And you can still see, even on this instrument, feel free to, after the talk, you feel free to come up. You can actually see the markings of where I press the strings. And so even after a year of playing, you would start to see really tiny indentations, right?
What kind of wood is that?
Well, it's made with sort of two of the most common materials. So this is, of course, two pieces, right? There's the top board and the bottom board. And in the middle, of course, is the chamber itself. This chamber is actually relatively small for this room, right? But the bottom board and the top board. And the top board is usually, almost always, made up of polonia. Polonia in the East Coast, I believe, it's known to be the Empress tree now. It's in, what's that? It's put into now. Sorry, I'm rambling. But the Empress tree is, polonia is a very lightweight wood, right? So of course it's very useful for making musical instruments. For instance, the koto, right? You guys are familiar with the koto, the top board is always made up of polonia, so not running, you hear the resonance. And also kanehamia. Kanehamia is a conifer, and that's also a lightweight wood. It's, I would say, in terms of the sound characteristic, it's a bit warmer than polonia. Yeah, polonia is more, it's got a punch to it, but kanehamia is more, of course, kanehamia is native to China. But that gives a more warm sound. They are lightweight. Actually, so the bottom instrument, that's a Song Dynasty instrument. That's also 900 years. It's also a very pretty instrument. I will briefly talk about some of the archaeological evidence that we have for the chin. So some of you might be familiar, but in Hubei province in 1978, they really found a wonderful, it's a tomb, of course, the tomb of Marquis Yi of Zheng. Zheng, of course, was a city-state, right? It was a city-state of Chu state, I believe. The site is late-Qing in Suzhou, and they found these bells. And these bells, of course, very useful because they actually gave an idea, at least a snapshot, of the type of music that was produced in China at that time. So this was the Warring States period. So 5th century BC. And more recently, just in 2016, this is the spring and autumn period. So the early Warring States period, they also found a chin. So this is the oldest chin ever found in China, or chin-like instrument, because it does resemble the chin, and I think most of the scientists in China do believe that the chin has probably descended, evolved from an instrument looking like this. So this is the type of chin that is found in the tomb of Marquis of Yi. It's very interesting because you can see that it does only have one peg for the mounting of the strings. The back of it is actually removable, which is interesting to note. In the modern instrument, we have these two pegs here, and we call them goose feet. So of course, the outer four strings are mounted in the outer peg, right? The rest are mounted on the other one. And these are, this is an instrument with a round sound hole. Sometimes, actually most of the time, they are rectangular. For many people, especially beginning students, stringing this instrument is somewhat of a pain because you really have to, well, usually I tell my students, you have to leverage your weight, right? So in some of these ancient handbooks, you see, you know, the scholar like putting it on a stool first, quite this tall, but you know, doing like this, unlikely to be the case, you know, that's a lot of torque on your arms. But of course, I usually, of course, rest on it, use my weight, and then tune the instrument that way. And then these are the fine tuners. These are the pegs for the fine tuners. And so if you can see, these are the butterfly knots that you tie. And the butterfly knots, actually, the silk here, actually, this is twisted cord of silk. And you can see that, well, you guys can come up to look at this, but counterclockwise is tightening, right? So that pulls the string. And so there's no metal, well, at least traditionally, these are metal strings, right? But traditionally, there's no metal at all on these instruments. They're all wooden materials. And then the lacquer, oh, I forgot to talk about the lacquer. The lacquer is actually traditional of natural tree resin, right? And then that is mixed with deer horn powder or something very hard. Deer horn powder is the traditional material for mixing with natural tree lacquer. These anti-slip pads, these are modern. Traditionally, I think small bags of sand were actually used to stabilize the instrument. I would say that actually sandbags, that's something interesting to think about with the traditional way of doing things sometimes, because some of these pegs here, because of course the instrument stands on the pegs, right, they might not be even. So if you have a sandbag, sometimes you can just like move the sand around and then it sits evenly. That's why the older people know what they're doing. You know, all the younger people, they think they know what they're doing. I'll talk a little bit about the notation for the chin. Actually, the chin has its own special notation. The really word-heavy or character-heavy script that you see, that's the longhand method. The longhand method, actually, it died out around the Tang Dynasty about 1,200 years ago. And you can imagine why. Because there's really no timing. There might be hints of timing within those passages. But for the most part, it told you, left hand, what finger do you use? What position do you put it on? How much you should move? How many positions should you move from that original position? And so forth, right? So you can imagine left and right hand, you have very big. Yeah, you have a lot of pros going on, right? But soon after, of course, during the Ming Dynasty, this really took off. The shorthand method really is a composite. It's a composite of tiao. Tiao is the right hand technique for the index finger plucking outwards. Okay, so that's one thing, right? On the seventh string, using for the left hand the ring finger on the tenth position, right? And then maybe something like an upslide, or in the case, if it's not an upslide, maybe a downslide, right? So this gives you already almost everything you need to know to play that one note. And so that is the modern sort of all, if you look at present scores for the Guqin, you'll still see this coupled with either staff notation or number notation. So we, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. No rain, needs a lot. I think Yiping is washing her cups. So I'll play Drunken Ecstasy. It's a Ming Dynasty piece. It's actually found in that handbook. We are not drunk yet, but we'll be drunk on tea soon. Mm-hmm. Oh, feel free. Four individuals. You guys duke it out yourselves. I have nothing to do with it. So that concludes sort of our formal presentation, but of course we can leave it to Q&A if you would like to.